as I gander over the medical reports and the brain analysis and medical files I've collected over the years relating to my epileptic condition, I find myself remembering the stigma of years gone by, that residue even up to this day. It is our constant struggle to forget the stress and strife we have created in the past for past nations, and fears arise even to this day. The sins of the fathers stay the same in all outlets of life. As with most of the trial and devastation our country leaves behind, even to this day, all our beaten down ex-colonies want to do is to survive into that next day. The psychological and social effects are also evident, with family units being split up because of their fear over this condition, and the jobs market not allowing workers to even try and take part in normal life as we would see it. The World Health Organization tried desperately to teach the rest of the world, with minimal success it seems. Was at the end of the attack on York Drift in 1879. He probably felt a sense of inadequacy as he headed his men in the charge. I know that sinking feeling of old. He experienced being lost but found at the same time and continued to sink with unknowable joy into the eternal void that his consciousness provided, deeper into the never-ending waves of truth, feeling the calm of things to come. The storm of his mind died down. It was this experience he felt with the utmost intensity of attack. It was the last 2 days in January, and they had been exhaustingly squelchy, not to say dramatic. He was epileptic, and as a result of the incompetence, the Zulus saw this as the attack on the Unicorps that day was defeated. It is with this stigma that the prince found himself upbraided by his brother, the king, that week, and indeed his very life. In Africa today, for example, there are 5 neurologists to every 1,000 people, and the general populace still relies solely on juju, or magic, to solve the growing epidemic. The social understanding is overwhelming too, with a lot of inhabitants in rural areas believing that a spiritual doctor or church minister can get rid of the demon that lives within them for a massive fee. 80% are not really deaths per 1,000. The infant mortality rate reflects the adverse perennial environment that favours the development of secondary epilepsy. Funny that. It might be a main symptom of continuum and mechanical solidarity taking place, a state of affairs in which the average man is trapped by his own society that has been put upon him by an outside agency. A fake society, some people might say. Phenobarbital and sodium valproate are available only to those who can afford to pay, despite employment issues. The management of epilepsy is stricter to the individual communities and regions, which results in there being a reluctance to give help when travelling outside those regions, despite detrimental conditions the patient might be in. 465,000 million people in the UK have epilepsy, and 30% have learning disabilities as a result of that epilepsy. We institutionalise those with such disabilities without recognising their independence or looking into the possibility that they might be able to overcome these difficulties. The only thing that might be needed, even the most severe of cases, is understanding and support. However, we in Britain see the fear in the eyes of conservative institutionalism and everyday life, and we run from the reality that those with challenges in their lives might have the possibility of overcoming their lives. We praise those who accomplish and excel in commercialism and careers without looking at those who have accomplished just as much by doing what might otherwise be considered the most mundane of things. Just surviving and tapping your own potential as a human being is perhaps the most triumphant of accomplishments. How much money you have can be said to be irrelevant. Pensions and the number of houses and cars you have can be said to be irrelevant. What you eat and how many holidays you have can also be said to be irrelevant. Febrile convulsions are caused by a change in temperature. I have seen epileptics all around the Africa and the more calm climes in the world. In particular, the pain of the unknown made its way time and time again with the ambitions and battles of Prince Damgunzi Kembunzi. These can lead to status epilepticus and considered the work of the devil by such nations. Here, ailing health delivery system continues to sink down into the abyss, resulting in, among other things, a serious shortage of epilepsy detecting machines, as well as an acute drug shortage in public referral hospitals, making life unbearable and harsh for people living with the condition. Yet these people struggle on, having to pay for attention during epileptic attacks before even being treated. Yet the UK still complain about an ailing and cracking health system and raising costs of treatment. I by no means disparage or intend to lessen the urgency or severity of the situation. I myself rely on the drugs and treatment provided by such institutions. My only intent in writing is to set a realisation to the overall big picture we try so hard in this country to block out. Prince Dumuzuki Mkembe was staunch in his attempts to protect his country and way of living. Even his independence are concepts we still fail to recognise in the country. The Epilepsy Support Foundation of Zimbabwe, ESFZ, 2014, reports that 60% of epileptics in the country are children, and these may suffer developmental delays both mentally and physically. Focus of determination that they are bound to overcome on their own. If, for example, an epileptic in this country were forced to live over there, the life expectancy of such an individual would be minimal. Drugs such as carbamazepine, sodium valproate, epinephrine, and other early developed drugs are the only ones available at large prices in the nation. Not only are they the only treatments available, they are also only available in South Africa. A dangerous place even to visit, even for those native to the continent. Turai Katvitsky, ESFZ advocacy officer, said, "Shortage of specialist medical personnel is a great challenge in both private and governmental hospitals. Currently, Zimbabwe has only two neurologists, which one has recently graduated, and there are no neuro nurses. This has led some epilepsy patients being assessed by psychiatric nurses who may end up diagnosing psychiatry instead of epilepsy. Not a good situation. The lack of modern treatments for epilepsy, such as lamotrigine and levetiracetam, is alarming, and phenobarbital, carbamazepine, and phenytoin. After 2 to 5 years of successful treatment, drugs can be withdrawn in about 70% of children and 60% of adults without relapses of seizures. Personal centered care, such as said by psychologist Carl Rogers, is virtually non-existent. Tom Kidwood developed person centered care in the 1980s, and it is the focus of all brain damage support we regard as the norm in the UK today. Nothing like that can be seen in such undeveloped countries. Kidwood states that person-centered care is founded on the ethic that all human beings are of absolute value and worthy of respect, no matter their disability, and on a conviction that people with dementia can live fulfilling lives. Our expectations and insistence on the rights established so long ago by a fractured and damaged nation have burned us to the realisation that we are in fact lucky to have the opulent lifestyle that we have in this blighted postmodern country of ours. It is only through consistent colonization and insistent capitalism that this is indicative of the East India Company and such short-sighted expansionists as Cecil Rhodes that we have such a society today, pattered and scabbed by old dank organic solidarity. I'm not sure that the Zulus shouldn't have wiped the Yundi Corp's faces with their feces at York's Drift, to be honest. The arrogance towards Western self-indulgence and expectations is boundless. Heather wafts through collective time, a free commodity for which we don't pay a dime. The street is filled in the shadows of the line.
Next time on Retrospective Rumours, I'll be looking at the decline in family values and how one such case at the end of the medieval period influenced modern and postmodern attitudes towards the gradual de-escalation of respect within the family unit today. This in turn influenced the lowering sperm count and rise of humanism and positivism among today's fractured ethical culture.
Gander of medical reports.
Trying to get this bloody thing to pair. Not even pairing properly. It's windy as well, I can tell you about much. It's fucking windy. Right, okay, let's just try and put you here, okay? Just get you there. And. God. It's intriguing, to say the least. Not intriguing, blooming annoying. But there you go, never mind, it's part of the job, innit? Houses, I find the most obscene in spots to do these things, I don't know, it's just incredible.